Welcome. In this lecture, you will learn which strategies there are available to control the exposure to indoor air pollutants. It will be no surprise to you that an important control strategy for indoor air quality is to reduce emissions of pollution sources as much as possible by applying source control. Source control means to prevent or minimize emissions from any possible source, thus using low-emitting products and materials, clean and maintainable heating, ventilation and air conditioning systems, and minimizing certain pollutants to enter or being distributed in a space. To minimize the emissions of products and materials in the frame of requirements in the European Construction Product Directive, a number of member states have introduced a national evaluation scheme for construction products and/or a voluntary evaluation scheme with an emission label. These schemes and labels can help you to select products with low volatile organic compound emissions and low odor. It should be noted that in some of these evaluation schemes, next to VOC measurements, odor measurements are performed using trained or untrained panels of persons. To reduce direct transmission of SARS-CoV-2 from an infected person, physical distancing has been adopted. For indirect transmission, cleaning services, washing hands, and sneezing, coughing in the elbow. And for people who need to or tend to come close to possible infected persons, personal protective equipment is used, such as facial masks and protective gloves. Additionally, the use of proper ventilation measures has been recommended. This means, first of all, to provide sufficient and effective ventilation. Ventilation that ensures the supply of clean air and exhausts polluted infected air from the breathing zones of each individual person, preferable without passing through the breathing zones of other persons and without recirculation, reuse of air. If general ventilation seems not enough or recirculation, reuse of air cannot be avoided, add air cleaning devices. Let's start with air cleaning. Air cleaning in most mechanical ventilation systems comprise of filtering the outdoor incoming air of particles smaller than 10 micron by a cassette filter and a particle smaller than 2.5 micron by a bag filter. Additionally, for cleaning of ultrafine or nanoparticles, such as bacteria and viruses, HEPA, high efficiency particulate air filters can be used. But these are usually only used when air is reused, recirculated, for example in operation theaters or clean rooms. Another air cleaning technique that can be used to clean the air of viral, bacterial and fungal particles is ultraviolet germicidal irradiation, in particular the UVC part of the UV spectrum. Since the outbreak of corona, both cleaning techniques have been used in mobile form as an additional measure indoors. For cleaning air from gaseous pollutants, some ways are available. For example, active carbon filters to filter the air of volatile organic compounds, or a layer of titanium dioxide on a surface in combination with UV light. Additionally, plants have been used. Plants make people feel better, less stressed, and can influence therefore their well-being. However, for the removal of pollutants through the leaves of the plant, you need a lot of them. Therefore, studies are being performed with active systems. Air is sucked actively through the medium in which the plants grow. In that medium, for example, bacteria or active carbon are added to remove pollutants from the air. Then, last but not least, ventilation is used as a control strategy for indoor air quality. Ventilation can be established by just opening a window, natural ventilation, or can be established by using a mechanical ventilation system varying from only exhaust to very advanced air conditioning systems that supply and exhaust the air. Mechanical ventilation gives the possibility to control the amount of air that is supplied, exhausted and/or reused, while natural ventilation, such as opening a window, is an uncontrolled form and therefore a less reliable way. Next to the type of ventilation, also different ventilation principles can be selected, such as mixing ventilation, displacement ventilation, cross-ventilation, and personal ventilation. With mixing ventilation, the air pollutants are diluted and therefore reduces the number of infectious aerosols in the air. Displacement and cross-ventilation move the air horizontally or vertically through space, replacing polluted air with fresh air. And then personal ventilation supplies and or exhausts air in the breathing zone of each person. Now, how much ventilation is required? Now, this is not an easy question to answer. Current guidelines for air quality indoors are mainly based on the CO2 concentration in air that is allowed. CO2 is used as an indicator of the presence of people. With the equation shown here, it is possible to calculate the required ventilation rate per person in a space to keep below the allowed CO2 concentration. The air distribution effectiveness in that equation tells us something about how effective the air is distributed. For complete mixing, this value is 1. Now, assuming a limit value of 1200 ppm, an outdoor concentration of 400 ppm, and a seated adult producing 18 liters CO2 per hour, this would result in a required ventilation rate of 6.25 less a liter per second per person for a ventilated room with an effectiveness of 1, and twice as much for a room with an effectiveness of 1.5. Whether these values are enough to prevent transmission is not known yet. To summarize this lecture, an important control strategy for indoor air quality is to reduce emissions of pollution sources as much as possible by using low-emitting products and materials, source control. If that is not possible, for example, when you are cooking or the outdoor air is polluted, then you can choose to ventilate and or clean filter the air. How to ventilate properly and how much ventilation is required depends on the pollutants and the situation. Thank you for your attention.